In this session, I'm going to take a regular Windows application that was built using the WinUI 3 platform and improve it using some prefabricated third-party controls from ComponentOne. I'll show how easy it is to swap or upgrade to these controls and show some of the benefits and how they can accelerate your application development. But first, just a brief background. My name is Greg, and I've been working at Grape City for over 10 years, working closely with their ComponentOne UI controls. ComponentOne is a set of reusable .NET components, and I'll come back to more of that later. As I mentioned, I'm going to use WinUI 3, but you might wonder, what is that? So let me quickly catch you up on where we are today with .NET desktop development. Over the years, Microsoft has kept evolving their Windows operating system, and with it, they improve the tooling. And they make the tooling available for developers to extend the operating system. From Windows Forms, which is what you think of when you think of classic Windows desktop applications, to WPF, or the Windows Presentation Foundation, which evolved the styling capabilities with vector-based drawing and improved data binding. Then we had the Windows Runtime for Metro, Windows 8 style apps. And the latest one is often referred to as just WinUI, which stands for the Windows User Interface Platform. WinUI 2 is used to develop UWP applications for Windows 8 and 10, and WinUI 3 lets you target Windows 10 and higher. There are other benefits to WinUI 3, such as a default, modern, fluent style, better performance than WPF, and it can run on more types of devices like the Xbox, Surface tablets, and IoT devices. And WinUI has taken this modern, minimalistic base that we got abruptly with WinRT and continues to build upon it. So here I have a completed WinUI 3 application. It's a very light email client. And I'm not saying that anyone needs to develop their own mail client, but it's used here as just a familiar layout that we want to emulate. Now let me give you a tour of the code and the structure. Here it's a Windows application template that targets version 10 using .NET 6. And the application is structured loosely following MVVM practices, which stands for Model View View Model. And MVVM basically separates the business logic from the UI. So all of our data processing is in the view model, and the view just focuses on the UI. Think of it like designing an application so that you could create 10 or any number of views that all share the same view model. They all share the same data. And this modular approach is very popular with XAML-based development platforms like WPF, MAUI, and WinUI. The view model here has three observable collections for mail, appointments, and contacts. And using observable collections here is nice because when there's any update to the data values, the UI will observe these changes automatically. And here we also have the model classes defined for email, appointments, and contacts. And here on our main view page that we're focusing on, it's called outlookpage.xaml. Now there are some other pages and views in this application, but for this, I'm just focusing on this one page. The XAML here is our application markup, and it defines the user interface layout. It's very similar to HTML. At the top, we have our library namespaces, and then we have resources, which are basically these reusable styles that can be referenced throughout the page elements. And then below that, we have the actual layout that's all nested within this grid component. The UI is composed of several controls, such as grids, stack panels, and borders. And most of these layout controls are native to the framework, except for one. And that's the one that we're going to be focusing on today, and that is the data grid. Microsoft has made the data grid available through its Community Toolkit. So traditionally, Microsoft has provided a standard set of UI components for each development platform. And this goes all the way back to Visual Basic. And now with the .NET Foundation being open source, some of these UI components, like for WinUI, are also open source. And for WinUI and some platforms, Microsoft also provides an additional toolkit of UI controls that you have to download and reference separately. For WinUI and UWP, this is called the Windows Community Toolkit. So these components are a bit more niche compared to the standard ones that Microsoft would normally provide, like image editors and carousels. And the toolkit is part of the .NET Foundation. You can get it on GitHub. You can also browse these through a demo app in the Windows Store that I'm running right here. The philosophy is that these standard controls, plus the toolkit ones, provide all the basic essential functionality the building blocks to create a bare minimum UI for most types of applications. When you need additional features or controls, you are then left to build them yourself or license a third-party set. So this toolkit WinUI Datagrid, it's good for simply displaying and editing our tabular data. You know, I believe we can sort, we can group the data by just one level. We can resize the column headers. But you'll find that most of the features stop about there, and there's a lot more that we may want from our data grid. It is open source, so we could attempt to extend it and add the features that we need. But what most companies do is purchase a set of advanced components developed by larger teams. So in addition to more features, these third-party controls are usually faster and take advantage of more advanced rendering features to optimize performance, whether it be data virtualization or DirectX rendering. So we know there are reasons why you may want to upgrade to a more powerful data grid. But now let me finally walk through some coding as I attempt to replace this toolkit data grid with the ComponentOne FlexGrid. So ComponentOne has hundreds of controls across every .NET platform. These libraries typically start with C1. So for WinUI, I'm going to look for the C1.WinUI.grid NuGet package here and add it to my application. So FlexGrid is the WinUI data grid, one of our popular controls that we've supported in pretty much every .NET platform. And adding this NuGet package here will also add any of its dependencies. And once it's added, we need to just add the XML namespace to the top of our XAML page that will include the FlexGrid. So here in this area, we can give it any prefix we want. So I'm going to give it the prefix of grid, G-R-I-D. And we're going to set this to using c1.winui.grid namespace. So now we can reference FlexGrid within our markup using that prefix. So now what I want to do is just show how easy it is to swap and replace the regular data grid with FlexGrid. So I'm literally just going to type in FlexGrid right here into the space next to the data grid. And then I'm just going to go ahead and copy all the properties over to FlexGrid. We're going to handle this very brute force. And we see immediately that one of these properties is not compatible, the selection mode. The reason for that is that FlexGrid supports 10 different selection modes, such as multi-cell, range, non-adjacent rows and cells, many different options available compared to just the two supported by the toolkit data grid. So if we want just a single row here, I'll set this property to row. And next I'm going to copy over the columns collection. Now these are predefined columns, which is required if you set the auto-generate property to false, auto-generate columns property. This determines which columns from our data set will be visible. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to have to change all of the prefixes for these columns to the new one. And you'll notice they aren't completely compatible. So here I'm changing all of the prefixes from MS to grid. And you'll notice that the class name is also not compatible. I'm going to have to change this to the FlexGrid column class, which is just called grid column. FlexGrid has a single column class data type that supports all different data types in the grid. So we just have to change all of these to grid column. And you'll notice that the first column here is actually displaying an image. You can put anything you want in the column by editing the cell template. So if FlexGrid does not have a special data template type of column, you can just simply edit the cell template for all the columns. We also see here this visibility property is not compatible, so I'm going to change that to isVisible equals false. FlexGrid also has other properties and benefits compared to the standard data grid. For example, we expose all these different brush properties so you can style different parts of the control, like the column header background. We can just set this to match the background gray of our application, that way it doesn't stand out. And before we run this, we need to also update the code behind. So in order to do that, I need to get rid of the old data grid. That way, Visual Studio will alert me to any of the problems in the code behind. So I'm going to scroll down here and look for these red marks. So here we have a bunch of more visibility properties set. So as I briefly rushed through on the other page, you know, FlexGrid columns, you can toggle their visibility with a Boolean is visible property as opposed to the visibility property. So I just have to change all these. It looks like in this section of code, we're toggling the visibility of certain columns based upon which panel of the application we're in, whether it's the inbox or the outbox. So we're going to set all these, and there's a bit more down here. So I scroll down here, I see. So here we have the mail grid selection changed events. This is what fires whenever the selection of the grid changes. Now what I'm going to do here is, because this is an event that's different, I'm actually going to jump back over to the XAML and let Visual Studio auto-generate the event handler for me, because FlexGrid uses slightly different parameters. I believe it actually is passing in the more data about the selected row that you can work with in this in the code behind. We don't necessarily need all of it for this example. We'll be able to just copy over the code that we had from the previous event handler. We'll be able to just copy this over, and we're going to keep the functionality about the same. I just need to address some of these other properties that are not going to build for me here. So the data grid calls it the selected item. In FlexGrid, this is just called the selection. And then what we're trying to do here is we're trying to actually get the underlying data item. So the selection alone does not provide the data item, so we need to actually go into the row, the selected row, that from the data grid, and then from there we can get the underlying data item of the mail, the piece of mail, the email, and then we'll take that and then display it in the panel below the grid. So now I can finally build this application and see FlexGrid. Now, it may not be as apparent through this video, but FlexGrid feels very smooth with fast scrolling. It uses high-performance cell recycling, so there's minimal memory consumption for each row's elements. This is typically referred to as UI virtualization. For extreme performance, you can even implement data virtualization, otherwise known as lazy loading or on-demand loading, and that's where data is pulled from the server in chunks. But yet, while FlexGrid would look and behave as if the entire data set is present. So here you can see we can sort the column headers by clicking them. So here we can continue to select the rows, and we can see the selected email below the grid. But now I want to continue to enhance this application and add more features. Now, as I mentioned before, you can sort and filter the data grid control, but it's a bit complicated because you essentially have to create a new filtered data set and then repopulate the data grid with that new data set. With FlexGrid, we've made the filtering features more add-on and easier to implement. So one of my favorites is the essential text search. Basically, it lets users search across the entire data grid, kind of like a Google search box. More technically, it's called the full text filter. But not only does FlexGrid filter, but we can also highlight the data. So what I'm going to do here to implement this is we need to add just a regular text box to our application. And I'm gonna add this up here in the stack panel next to the user login information. We're gonna name it txtsearch. We're gonna give it some placeholder text that just says search. And we'll set the width to 200. So now we have a text box on our page. Now we need to connect it to the FlexGrid. And FlexGrid has, you know, built-in full text filtering capability. So all we have to do is basically set one property on FlexGrid. But this is within a behavior called the full text filter behavior. So within the behaviors collection here, I'm going to simply define this full text filter behavior and then set the filter entry. We're going to bind it directly to that element called txt search, and that's it. And then this entire feature is implemented with just that minimal coding. Now let's see what it looks like. And this is adding, like I said, a text box at the top to search. FlexGrid also supports a traditional filter row where, you know, a text field is sort of displayed at the top of each column. But I think the text box search is a bit more modern in what users would expect. So here we can type in anything and it's filtering and highlighting the rows in our data grid. And you can see here it's not only searching the visible fields, but the invisible content, such as the email content. And you can customize the full text filter, based upon case sensitivity, matching whole words, choosing which fields from the data set to filter, etc. The next feature I want to add is multi-level grouping. So as I mentioned before, grouping with a standard data grid is limited to just one level. And of course, with an advanced data grid like FlexGrid, we can group by multiple levels. So FlexGrid uses an internal collection view type of class called the data collection. And it's through this object that we can transform the data with minimal coding. So here with this one line of code using the group by, or I'm sorry, the group async method, we can group the data grid and we simply just pass in the name of the field that we want to group by. So here we're going to group it by the date, essentially. And why stop there? Let's go ahead and just group it by two columns. So by simply, it accepts an array of values, but we can also just type this out with a column. We're going to also group by the full name after we group by the date. So let's go ahead and run this and see what it looks like. And you'll see here that FlexGrid is also displaying the aggregated data within the group row. So it's showing you how many items are within each group. That's just default behavior, but we can also customize the group header template if we want to customize how that is displayed. And we could continue to group by more than two levels, but I think at a certain point it starts to become more difficult to use. So you do have to make smart choices for your application. And for my last trick, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show off the row details feature of FlexGrid. So this is going to defy the traditional Outlook template, which is displaying the email content below the grid in a separate panel. But for this, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to show the email content within each row of the flex grid within an expandable panel below the row. So what I'm going to do here, this feature is called the row details feature, and it's supported with FlexGrid using the FlexGrid row provider or detail provider behavior. So all I have to do is simply add this to the behaviors collection. Now this is going to give us a data template that we will then define the template that we're going to put within this detail. So we can add text boxes or any element that we want, and then we'll set the bindings within that element. But what I'm going to do here, since I already have this defined within that expander, I'm going to go ahead and just copy the scroll viewer here into a data template within the detail provider. And that's pretty much it. Now there's some other little cleanup that we can do here. So for example, we don't want to display, so there were two different templates defined for this email. There's no selected email or selected email. We're going to use the selected email because every row, is essentially selected. I also want to go ahead and hide the other panel that was below the FlexGrid. That will give FlexGrid the whole window to display. And also, I'm going to go ahead and, the row detail feature uses the row column, the row header of the FlexGrid. In this application, we're only displaying the column header. So I want to make sure that we're displaying both the column and the row headers. And we're going to disable grouping just for this. Because like I said before, we want to make sure the grid looks good. And I think having row details and grouping might be too much going on at the same time, but you certainly could implement all of these features together if you want. So what the row details here is doing is giving you a little arrow on the left, and that allows you to expand the row details, and it's showing now the email content within each row. So that about wraps up everything I wanted to show in this session. By using a third-party control like the ComponentOne FlexGrid, we're able to accelerate the application development by adding these features quickly by just setting a few lines of code that would otherwise take us a long time to implement using the standard data grid control. So you can learn more about ComponentOne's hundreds of .NET UI controls for every .NET platform at grapecity.com/ComponentOne. Thanks for watching.